Thank you for listening to this podcast from TRE, Talk Radio Europe, your voice in Spain and around the world. For more information, please visit tre.radio.
The Lifestyle Show.
Selina MacKenzie.
Our brains are incredibly adept at repair.
The Me Nobody Sees.
We create our own realities.
A deep insight into mental health.
Of a long intro there. Sorry about that. Trying to get hold of Sally on the line. This is indeed the Me Nobody Sees. Hopefully you know what it's all about now. We feel that it's crucial in this day and age to share our stories and break down the stigma of mental health problems. We invite you to join in our conversation. Today we're going to be chatting about bereavement, amongst other things. You can call on 952 78 4000, WhatsApp 645 99 67 95, or email studio at tre.radio.
The Me Nobody Sees, a deep insight into mental health.
Oh, that finished quite fast. So I'd like to welcome on the phone Sally Williams. Hi, Sally.
Hi, Selina.
And I'd like to welcome in the studio Michelle Mack.
Hello, Selina.
Hello, Michelle. And our new councillor, Deb Jones. Welcome.
Hi, Selina.
Nice to have you all here with me. So, as we know, the show sort of goes off at its own pace, whatever you want to talk about mental health related. But the subject we're going to try and concentrate on is bereavement today. And, Michelle, I know you've had a tough couple of weeks.
Yep. We have. Well, it's been a tough few months, actually. We lost a very young family member towards the latter part of last year. And recently we've just lost a very good friend unexpectedly.
It's when they're so young that it gets you, isn't it? It's when they're so young that it's tough.
Yes, very much so. You know, when it's out of the natural order of things, it's much harder to comprehend and understand.
And do you, Deb, do you get a lot of people coming for help with bereavement?
Yes, I do. There seems to be quite a lot of the clients who've got the theme of losing people, whether through natural death or tragic death. But then, and it comes in clusters. And there's a
seems to all come up.
There's
once.
A particular big cluster at the moment.
Yeah.
I wonder why that is. Whether it's a sort of
strange, isn't it?
It is, but it does seem to be extremely prevalent at the moment.
Yes, I know a few people this last few weeks as well. Somebody, as we mentioned on the line, the lovely Sally Williams. Sally, I know that you lost, and everyone here on this end of the coast will know the fantastic Mel Williams, what a fantastic singer and personality he was. But yeah, it wasn't until we spoke this morning that I realised you've suffered lots of losses.
Yes. Can you hear me, Selina?
Yes,
half deaf, and with this cold I'm struggling, but I've got it right up to my ears. So just tell me if you can't hear me.
Okay, we can hear you.
Yeah, it was just like, I don't know if that was Debbie or Michelle just said, it comes in clusters. And for many, many years, I was very lucky not to be bereaved. I was a really lucky person because I had my mum, my dad, my three brothers and sisters, and my husband. And life was trucking along. And then in the space of, I think it was something like 8-9 months, I lost my dad first, who was 90, which was a bit the order of things, and he was happy to go. So, but it was still a shock. I'd had my dad till I was 62, so I was like, wow, you know, it's still hard. And then I lost my 57-year-old brother 3 months later in March. And then I lost darling Mel in August. By which time I was just reeling with it already. It just felt like I was, every time I stood up, I was like one of those those things that weebles wobble, but they don't fall down. You know, I kept getting bashed down and then bouncing back up again.
Bless
and then
you.
At the end, towards the end of the year, I lost my darling bestie, Patty Merchant, my film colleague, wonderful makeup artist and friend. And so it all happened in like 8 months, and that was in 2018. And I do believe the accumulated grief actually has had a knock-on effect, and I think it's delayed a little bit. And I feel in the last, maybe lovely counsellor lady would understand this, in the last sort of 6 months, I feel I've been almost grieving more that year than I did at the time. It was almost like I was a bit numb.
Does that make sense to you, Deb? Yeah, Deb's nodding her head. Yeah. Is that what happens?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the human brain can only take so much so much trauma, and grief can blow us sideways. And I think if you've got a wave of events coming in, the brain protects ourselves and shuts down a bit, and it's not until it's over and the brain starts to work again and the emotions start to reconnect, then that's when we start to feel it.
And it's important to grieve, isn't it? Because if you don't grieve, you aren't going to get over it.
It's really interesting, actually, that you said that. I struggled for a very long time with grief, particularly I lost I never lost anyone in my life until I was in my 20s for the first time, and I lost my great-grandmother. And then the biggest impact was my grandmother, when my grandmother died. And I was at the time going through IVF. And I really struggled with grief and with loss. And it took me a lot of work to understand why and come to a happy place with that. And actually, I went on a bit of a pilgrimage. I went to India to Varanasi, where the death ghats are, specifically to try and overcome a lot of those issues. And it made a great difference to me. I'm not saying everybody should go and do that. But yes, it's...
Wow.
It's very interesting how it affects us all so differently.
And what would you advise if I was coming to you, Deb, and I just lost a loved one, and I said I just don't know what to do? What sort of tips could you give out?
Well, if you're coming to me as a client, it would be just spending time with the story, giving you a chance to talk about what that person meant to you. But of course, we've all experienced grief in our lives. And when someone dies in the present, we're not just grieving for that person too, we're grieving for everyone else. So it comes in as a pot. To be able to have someone to just listen to you and let you tell your story and let you feel the emotions as they come up. Because a lot of people don't know how to respond when someone's upset. People want to move you on.
Yeah, people cross the road because they don't know what to say to you.
They do, and it can change relationships when someone important dies to you because people don't know how to respond, which can be very lonely. And so having someone to go to where you can just... talk about it and indulge in it and immerse in it. Yeah. It's very cathartic.
I think it's also about being normal with that person as well, because I've been through a whole year's cycle with a girlfriend of mine who lost her husband last year. And she's found that, like you said, so many people that she thought would be, you know, a great support to her actually haven't been, because they couldn't deal with their own grief at the loss. So they couldn't cope with her grief, and that's an interesting thing, because grief affects everybody, as I said, differently, and it's not linear. There's no time frame, there's no right or wrong, and you have to just go with the flow on that.
Yeah, I have heard somebody say before to somebody else, not to me, you know, isn't it about time you got over it? And that's an awful thing to say. I should imagine you never get over it, like Sally's just said. You all right there, love? You got some water?
Yeah. That's why I'm keeping away, if I'm not spreading my germs around your table.
We're very grateful, Sally. Thank you.
I'd love to meet you. One day I will make it, I promise. I just wanted to say that you know, my experience of grief in 2018, I was 62 years old. I mean, I felt so lucky and so privileged to have got, you know, so long with my mum and dad and with my family. But much earlier, I'd had another incredible loss when I was young. And maybe I learned a lot from that. I learned a lot from that.
Is it okay to tell everybody?
Yeah, I mean it's the first time I've spoken about it publicly, but a lot of people who were down here, I suppose at the time, no, very few people probably knew. Mel and I had a wonderful, you know, marriage. We were working in the holiday club. We were here for 8 years down there at Stepona, and we were living the dream, really. We had a beautiful little boy come along when we were working there. And we'd just taken the jump to leave the holiday club. And because Mel had literally been headhunted to go and sing in the port, in Joy's pub. And he was going to work in the port and, you know, be this big singing sensation in the port because there was no kind of live music at the time. And literally, I was pregnant again. We were over the moon. And I had a beautiful little girl, Rebecca Kate Lyons. And tragically, I was 27, I think, at the time. Mel was probably then 39 or something. She was that bit older than me. But everything was swimming. We had our lovely my stepson, Jason. We had little John Boy. And then along came Rebecca, and we were on cloud nine. And literally, back in those days, it was put down to hot death. That's what they said.
SIDS.
But yeah. Literally, she just passed away. She was in the same room as myself. There was no indication. There was no... Mel was there too. He was just getting ready to go and register her, ironically. And there was absolutely no indication, really. Of course, after something so tragic, you look back and was there something I could have done? Was there a sign? Was there anything? Yes, a little bit. She was a little bit sniffly, but we were going to the doctor that afternoon, so there didn't seem any cause for alarm. But she literally slipped away. And
I think for anybody that is a parent, the loss of a child is probably the hardest thing to deal with. Because it's out of the natural order of things, as we were discussing before. When you lose a parent and they're in their 90s, it's much more normal, but this is so out of everything, you know.
I think also it's because, you know, I've had a lot of time. I'm 66 now, so I've had a lot of time to think about it and study it. But talking about mental health, it's why I was so interested to come on the program, in case it can help somebody else, in case it can be of benefit.
I think it can.
It was such a massive, massive shock tragedy. I believe that day that I literally declared to the world, I will never, ever hurt like this again. I will never feel this pain again. And I believe I shut myself down mentally. I feel like a pressure cooker, that I just closed myself off.
Yeah, totally understandable.
In those days, you see, this was 1983 here in Spain. There was no counselling. There was no, you know. I was actually sent back because afterwards I hemorrhaged and had all sorts of problems, probably from the shock. And was sent back to the same hospital, same ward, same everything.
Oh, crikey.
Where everybody That's was tough. Giving birth and, you know, everybody was all... See, mental health-wise, I mean, it was an absolute nightmare, I suppose, looking back.
Yeah.
Literally, when you lose a baby that young, I was breastfeeding, so I had to be literally bound. I mean, it was horrendous.
I'm sure it was, and thank you for sharing that with us.
But I'm sharing it because I believe I haven't been able to share it before. Or privately I do, if anybody needs help. But what I wanted to sort of come through from it, please God, if anything happens to anybody that you know, advise them to have help and have counselling and talk to talk and deal with it and try. I mean, maybe people did try and help me. I have close friends. I'm lucky. But it just wasn't available then. It wasn't the norm. You know, people did literally cross the street. People didn't know what to say. Anybody who walked up to you had tears in their eyes. Oh. You couldn't, you know. Mel had to go and sing every night.
Oh.
You know, we had to eat.
Yeah, carry
he
on.
He had to be that funny, chirpy little man that he was.
Oh, and he was. He so was.
I know, and he was doing that literally after that had happened. You know, it was like, oh, my God.
Well, I know that... Yeah, I know Deb wants to just come in here and I think talk to you.
Hi, Sally. Hi.
Hi.
Yes, I'm sorry to hear the story that you've gone through and how you had to cope all those years. As you said, you never wanted to feel pain like that again. And I wonder if this is a question for our viewers. If you, in hindsight, looking at how you locked away that pain and found a way to cope, looking back, what could you have done differently to process that grief?
I believe... I think if there'd been more help available in... I don't know, because maybe people did try to say to me, you know, you should go and speak to somebody, and maybe I turned it away. That's also possible, because, you know, there was that kind of stoic that you get on with things and... You know,
I think sometimes as well you shut yourself down, don't you?
Yeah,
I totally shut myself down.
And also the fact is that it was different back then. We do talk about things now, and like Sally said, there are counsellors and people we can go to, but we're talking nearly 40-odd years ago, aren't we, Sally?
Absolutely. Well, we're, 1983.
Mm.
So it will be 40 years this... In November, she would be 40 years old. My goodness.
Yeah, I have a girlfriend who lost a daughter... 30-odd years ago in the 90s, and she still struggles to this day.
I mean,
and even 10, and that was in the UK, and even 10 years on, there still wasn't the support and the help that, you know, often these things are such taboo subjects that people don't know how to approach you and, you know, don't know what to offer you.
Yeah. I want to read out something that Sally sent me. Thank you very much, Sally. It's very sweet and I think it'll help people. And then we need to take our first advert break. But just before the show, Sally sent me. I'm trying to read it from my phone, so I'm hoping I can read it. It's called Take Them With You. If someone you love did not make it on that trip, you can take it for them, with them. If someone you love did not witness that milestone, you can show them anytime you like. If someone you love did not get to do their living, you can finish those dreams off on their behalf. The beautiful thing about love, you see, is that death need not stop life. If you carry someone in your heart, you can take them with you anywhere.
The Lifestyle Show, presented by Selina MacKenzie.
We are back. This is the Me Nobody Sees. Thank you for joining us. I have Michelle, Deb and Sally with us on the phone. Just going back to what we just read out, Deb, I know you wanted to point something out about that.
Yeah, it was a really poignant poem there. What I wanted to pull from that is that when someone passes, that we... Our life doesn't have to stop because of that, and we can get very stuck and stuck with our loss and with our sadness, but actually so much good can come from this, and we can learn so much from ourselves. You know, what did that person mean to us, that when they died, what did they take with us? Because we can feel more whole when we're in relationship with someone, and when they pass, they take that with us.
Yeah.
What did we not achieve with that person that we can go on to achieve? And that we can get past loss, because it's one of life's really difficult lessons.
Mm.
We do experience loss all the time, but it can also strengthen us as people to learn that, to know that we can get through it and past it, and, you know, a lot of good can come from it.
Yeah, they say, don't they, you never actually get over it, but you learn to live with it.
To walk around it and integrate
exactly,
it.
Yes, exactly, manage it. I can't imagine, I really can't imagine for Sally, the losses she's gone through. Michelle, I know we've chatted before, it's a tough one. Sally, go on,
yeah.
go on.
No, you say.
I was just going to say, and I know that losing Mel was a massive loss for you, and it was a massive loss for the whole coast. but you got your son, of course. You've got your son, and I suspect he looks a lot like Mel, does he?
I've got three of them.
Wow.
I have three boys, yeah, Jason, John and Mike, and they're all, you know, they all sing and perform and act and do stuff. I mean, I truly believe they meld with them wherever they go. They've all got a bit of the old man in them somewhere.
Well, we've got a couple of WhatsApps coming in. Maggie said, advice for anybody, I joined a local bereavement group on Facebook and that really helped. That's a really good... I didn't know they had bereavement groups on Facebook, but that's a
there
great
There are side. Bereavement groups all over the place. Actually, my girlfriend who lost her husband last year just sent me... I'll have to find where it is. She found this woman who'd written an amazing book, an American woman, on Instagram, of all places, and she said it helped her massively. So there's so much more access to stuff than there used to be.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's bereavement cafes, apparently, in Mallorca.
No way.
Yeah, there's bereavement cafes, yeah, you can go and sit and have a coffee and talk to somebody.
It's not a bad
but that's
idea.
I think that's not such a bad idea.
People should not talk about
all.
It. Yeah.
I think that's the key issue. It's a subject that's still not really talked about very much.
Mm. Totally. The trouble also is that if you don't talk about it, like what happened to me when I lost the baby, 10 years later, I had what was then called a nervous breakdown. Well, that was totally from bottled up grief.
Yeah.
You know, it's like a pressure cooker. If you don't have an outlet, it doesn't matter if you're going to a cafe or talking, however you can let out that grief, it's like steam being let out of a pressure cooker.
Yeah.
Emotions have to find a way out. And if we bottle them up and box them away, you know, the box rattles for years until one day it's blown open.
Mm.
You know, like you experiencing a mental breakdown. And one of the common physical ailments following grief is chest infections.
Really?
You know, energetically, our chest and our lungs hold the grief. And so in order for us to process grief, if we can't emotionally process, the body does it for us. And so therefore, chest infections, pneumonia, coughs.
All around the heart, all centered around the heart.
Yeah, it's the energy center for grief.
Yeah, there's a massive association, isn't there, with the mental health and physical health.
Yeah, a huge correlation. Yeah. Our body is our greatest communicator.
That's not what you've got now, Sally, a chest infection.
No, I think I've just got a regular rotten cold coming back from England. I just went to see my mum, so lucky, and just got back. I wanted to say also, though, on a positive note, I mean, I'm a really positive person, as you know, in as much as, you know, I it sounds like, God, yes, it was tragic and it was terrible. I'm not dissing what happened to us or to me, but there's been so many incredibly positive things that came out of it. And, you know, our daughter lived for 5 days, but that 5 days gave me an incredible burning desire to help children generally, underprivileged children, any children I could help. And I know fellow friends on the coast, similar circumstances, we banded together to help a lot of kids. So positive things do come out of the most tragic losses.
Yeah, that's a nice way of looking at it.
I think so. Mel's legacy, you know, we bought some guitars for kids who couldn't get guitars, and just anything you can do, I think, to convert your grief into something positive, some positive action.
Yeah.
You don't feel like it when you're grieving. You feel like awful because it's awful, it's horrible.
Yeah.
Particularly, I think, when you lose your partner and everything's different, you're only making one cup of tea or, you know.
Yeah, it's tough, it is. I just want to go back to some of these WhatsApps. This one's for you, Deb. A lady called Anne said, I lost my son Sean almost 3 months ago. I was told I need to get over it. He was only 30, that I just need to move on. I'm sorry, but I don't know how, because it just hurts to breathe without him.
Wow. I'm so sorry to hear that. And 3 months, just after 3 months, being told you have to get on with it.
That's hilarious, isn't
it? No, you're probably still in those very early stages of grief where denial and shock. All I can suggest right now is be really gentle on yourself, and if you can find someone to talk to, a therapist, if the therapist near you, just to be able to go and process the initial stages and let this unfold. Grief is like layers of an onion, you know, you're just peeling this back layer by layer at the point that you can cope with it. And I know that we tend to go with the people who are close to us and hoping that they will listen to us, but if you're repeatedly getting the same answers, as, you know, find other places
actually,
to go.
It's sometimes easier to talk to somebody that you're slightly detached from and there isn't that emotional involvement with, because they can be a little bit more philosophical about things with you. And I remember with my girlfriend Claire, she went into sort of this automatic pilot mode after Mike died and just went hell for leather into everything. And I kept saying to her, you're going to hit the wall, you're going to hit the wall. 3 months in, bang, she hit the wall and she slid down it completely and then fell apart. And I said to her, you know, it's fine. It's okay not to be okay. And I think that's the key thing. It's okay not to be okay.
And my advice to Anne, not being a counsellor, but my advice to Anne is just ignore these people who are saying you need to move on and get over it and cut them out of your life, because anyone that says that after 3 months of losing your son is shocking.
And take really good care of yourself. And as you said, you're finding it even hard to breathe right now. You know, the closest thing to you has been taken away and it's trying to make sense of it. So be gentle on yourself, be kind, and reach out for someone to talk to so that you can process this.
Is this lady here or in the UK?
I don't know. Anne, if you're listening to us, do let us know. I could probably point you in the right direction to speak to somebody. And if you're here, maybe speak to Deb. Yeah. Let's take our second advert break and we'll be right back on the other side.
The Lifestyle Show, presented by Selina MacKenzie.
We're back with the second half of the Me Nobody Sees. I'm with Michelle, Deb and Sally on the line. Right, we've just heard from Anne a terrible, terrible, tragic story about her losing her son. Do let us know where you are, Anne. And if you are over here, Deb can give her details out now or for anyone else that needs them.
Yeah, sure. I live and work in Marbella. I work online and face to face, so if you're not in the UK, then I can work with you online. My website is www.theenglishtherapist.com.
That's great, the English therapist, because you know if you're English,
that one.
English speaking, yeah, I bet you did. Yeah. That website.
Also, just to put it out there for anybody that is listening, that is only here on holiday or is based in the UK, very good starting point for anybody that needs bereavement counselling is CRUS bereavement counselling.
Oh, okay.
They're a national service in the UK, and their helpline number is 0808 808 1677.
Well done, Michelle. It's CRUSE spelt
CRUSE.
CRUSE, okay. And for any mental health issues, and one that I found is a great help as well, you can go to mind.org.uk. They're also very good help. Just had something else in. This is from Paul. And Paul said, I just want to let you all know that you must tell your loved ones and other significant people in your life that you love them as often as possible. You may not get another chance.
Yeah,
and that can be quite an issue for a lot of people, is that they feel that they haven't been able to say, and they feel that it's left inside them, that they've that they would have liked to have said something, they would have liked to repair relationships. What I want to say as a therapist is that, you know, we can't preempt what's ahead, but we can go back and heal it afterwards.
It's an interesting one, actually, and I don't know how all of you feel about this, but I was asked once, if I had to choose, I won't name a person, but if I had to choose a family member, would I rather them go quickly, but which is great for them, but not so good for me? Or would I rather them have an illness whereby I got a chance to say
I can
goodbye?
Answer that straight away.
Think of
for
them.
You.
Think of them.
I've been in both situations, and I would rather somebody went quickly.
Yeah, for their
and,
sake.
And there was no suffering. It's much harder for you, the person left behind, but watching somebody suffer for a long period of time is not nice.
It's a double grief, isn't it?
Yeah,
because
absolutely.
You're grieving the anticipation of when they're going to go.
Absolutely.
I guess you'd say the same, would you, Sally? I mean, I think with Mel, it was quick, wasn't it?
Yeah,
Yes and no. I mean, Mel had been very poorly for a long time, but he was just very good at hiding it.
Oh, right. Okay.
So although we as the family or close, you know, we knew, it wasn't sort of public knowledge. But I totally agree with Michelle that, you know, he went really quickly in the car with me. And I tend to think, well, I think how you heal from that quick death afterwards is to just feel so happy for them.
I just said this to my girlfriend. She lost her husband out of the blue.
Yeah.
Very recently. No warning. Absolutely no idea this was going to happen. And I said that the most important thing is to know that he wouldn't have known anything about it.
Yeah.
There was no suffering.
For them,
it was over. So for them, it's so much harder for the people left behind. But as you said, Debs, you can go back and you can heal. Whereas I think it's really hard to watch somebody you really love deteriorate over a lengthy period of time.
I think one of the worst ones, I mean, obviously they're all bad, whether it's cancer or whatever illness, but if somebody's got Alzheimer's or dementia, you have lost them before you've lost them.
Like a living death, isn't it?
Awful, yeah. awful.
So sad.
What about, Deb, telling or explaining or helping young people, like if somebody young's died and they've got young children, what's the best way to sort of explain to them?
You mean very young?
Well, yeah, sort of. They're sort of from ten upwards. I mean, I think if they're younger, it's a bit different. If you're 10 and upwards, you do sort of understand.
It's learning to talk to them on their level. You know, if it's a very young child, it's through storybooks and through imaginary conversations, and it's allowing that child to process their feelings. If children are in an environment where stuff is not talked about, then that can be really difficult. But it's maybe allowing the school to involve and get them some support. As children transition through early mid-childhood through to teenage years naturally they want to shut down, they want to shut out. Mm-hmm. And children can get lost in their grief and process it in a very different way, in a very deep internal way, and then act it out. And it's hard to access teenagers when they are dealing with difficult stuff because they don't know how to process it. You know, even the healthiest of teenagers are lost.
Yeah.
And having to deal with difficult stuff. It's finding the resources that can help them.
Mm.
And I work with teenagers too, so, you know, it's working in a much lighter way. But just allowing teenagers to talk about whatever they want, it might take a long time before they actually start to talk about the grief, but just letting them talk.
I think, I mean, you mentioned losing your great grandparent, which is incredible to have had a great grandparent alive, Michelle. I think when it's a grandparent, I mean, I was 15 when I lost my first grandparent, but it's the right order of things, like you both said, you sort
it,
of
it is, and I think also, you know, it's interesting. It's generally most people's first experience of losing somebody is losing a great grandparent or a grandparent. And I had no experience of that into my 20s, which was really quite incredible, really, considering. And I found it quite difficult to process because I'd had no experience of it. And nobody teaches you how to deal with these things. There's no life lessons in them.
And grandparents can be sometimes the most important relationships that you have because it's different. Mm. There's a different relationship between a grandparent and a grandchild and therefore can feel a lot closer and can feel a lot more supported than they'll get with their parents.
Can I just come in on this one?
Yeah?
Because we have an adored granddaughter, Odessa, who was 14 when Mel died. And for her, Mel was her absolute world.
Aww.
He was her grandfather, father, everything.
I completely understand that. I had the same...
Devastated.
When I lost my grandmother, I was the eldest of the grandchildren. I was the first. I was the only granddaughter. She had been... I had a better relationship with her at some points in my teenage years than I did with my own mum.
Mm.
And her death affected me more than anybody else's. And it was that prompted me to look at my own views on death and dying and how I could accept certain things. It took me years and years and years to get over what I saw as a failing of not seeing her before she died, because I'd been told, no, don't come, everything will be okay. And it wasn't.
Yeah.
And I beat myself up for years over that. Oh. And, you know, you can't do that.
No.
I couldn't have done anything to change it. But it was such a huge emotional loss that I didn't know what to do with it.
Yeah. I remember my paternal grandmother, my dad's mum, she died a horrifying death of cancer. She had breast cancer. And I used to go and see her every day in the hospital. And I can say, because it's not the BBC, but in my opinion, if I could have taken her life for her, I would have done. Because she was screaming in pain. They'd already said it was terminal. She'd only got a few weeks left. She's screaming in pain. How can you let somebody suffer like that? You don't let animals suffer like that.
Well, that brings you on to then where we are with the assisted dying,
which there is a law now in Spain, isn't there?
It is now legal, but you have to jump through a phenomenal amount of hoops.
Yeah.
And it isn't an easy process.
Yeah, I'm sure. You have to appreciate that, because it can be open to abuse, can't it? So you've got to really prove that the person's in sound mind, etc., etc.
Can I just say quickly that although Odessa tragically, you know, lost her granddad, she sang, she always sang with Mel. She has a beautiful voice, and she stopped singing. She didn't want to sing anymore.
Oh, that's a shame.
I know. But let me just say, she does sing in private. She's not a show type girl, but she does sing in private now. But she gave me the best bit of advice I ever got about grief. So I'd just like to share it, if it helps anybody who's listening out there. I said to her, not long after, when he died, she came to live with me, and she stayed with me for 6 months, literally sleeping with, you know, in my bed. She wanted to sleep on granddad's side of the bed. She was absolutely distraught. And, but she coped. She was coping. And when I said to her a few months later, Odessa, how are you coping? I have to say, I'm really amazed how you are coping. How are you doing it? Because praise her for her strength and getting through. And do you know what she said? She said, Grandma, she said, every time I want to cry about Granddad and I think of him, she said, I make myself think of him doing something really stupid and silly.
Oh.
And pulling a silly face or saying something really
stupid. That's a good idea. That's a good idea.
And I have to smile. And, you know, look, we're all laughing now. Because if you knew Mel, you knew he was very naughty, very cheeky, and very, you know. And it was such a wonderful thing to say. That it's helped me, and I know it's helped a lot of anyone who asks. I tell them that was my best grief tip. When I think of Mel, when I want to cry, I just think of the many stupid things she did.
Oh, bless you. The other thing is, I guess, that brings up another subject. Should you go and see the body? I went to see my grandfather's body. And to me, it helped. I hadn't seen him. I didn't know anything about him dying. It was a complete shock. And he just looked like he was asleep, so it's great. But I know other people have said, no, I don't want to remember them that way. I want to remember them like Sally said, laughing. So
for me personally, I'm sitting here looking at you like you've grown 2 heads, Selina. Because for me, I couldn't think of anything worse. I would want to remember the person as I remembered them.
Yeah.
And particularly if they'd been through a long illness or anything like that. And I know from my own family, those that have been and done that have said they wish they hadn't.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, some people do take comfort from it.
It's each to their own.
But I think it's very much an each to their own situation on that.
For some people, it helps them. It's concrete that it's happened.
Exactly.
So they're not in denial. They can actually see it from their own eyes. That will help them move on.
I think that's right. Otherwise, you'd be forever thinking, well, has he really gone? You know, you just... especially as a youngster. The other thing that somebody told me is a good thing to do is to help remember them, is to plant a tree or do something. Of course, I'm not foolish enough to think it's going to take the pain away, but something that you can remember them by.
It's a cathartic thing to focus the mind. And if you go sit on that bench, or you cuddle that teddy bear that's made out of their clothes, or you have a plant or a tree, it's just a place to stop and think.
You can get those now, can't you? You've just said something that's made out of their clothes. You can get, like, pillows made out of somebody's shirt.
You can, teddy bears.
Oh, that's brilliant.
Yeah, you can.
What a fantastic idea.
Can.
Have you seen that, Sally? They're really good.
I did it.
Interesting.
I did teddy bears out of all his rock and roll outfits for the grandpa.
I think that's such a lovely idea. I've got a friend that does that and makes them. You know, you send an old shirt or an old, you know, bits and pieces. However, there's all these wonderful things now where you can have the ashes compressed into like a diamond, or you can have them made into a rock. So I've got one daughter who thinks that's a fantastic idea and says, oh mum, that's amazing, I can carry a little piece of you around with me the whole time. And the other one, oh my god, that's so gross.
I bet I know what she's
doing. I'm sure you do. But also you can have put into a rocket. And I said, that's great. Yeah. I love that, because my birthday's just before bonfire night. And I said, fantastic. I said, shoot me up into the sky.
Me too.
You I'm too, Sally.
I've already told my children I'm going into a root ball. Put me into a root ball of a tree. I do not want to go in a coffin. Just grind me down. Put me in a bag. Plant a tree.
What is so important of this bit of the conversation? I'm just trying to sort of say this. I really think for anybody out there listening, please talk about it if you can with the person. Because Mel and I used to go to gigs night after night after night, and we talked, we never stopped talking. We were like the same person. But we talked of this, however difficult it is. I knew what Mel wanted. I knew exactly what he wanted. And he wanted to be suited and booted in his rock and roll outfit. And he wanted to be on display, because that was Mel.
I remember the bikes at the funeral. That was incredible, the motorbikes.
Yeah, he had a motorbike cavalcade. I didn't arrange that. They just appeared.
Oh.
That was because of his connections with Harley and with bikes. And people just heard about it and they appeared. And he had an amazing send-off. But the point was that he got what he wanted. And that brought me great peace.
Yes, good.
It brought me great peace at the time to know what he wanted, whatever it is, you know?
Yeah.
And I know it's a hard subject, but if ever, even in jest, even in laughing, if you do know what your loved one, whatever age, what their thoughts are, what they like, you know, it's a great thing to know, because otherwise you must be very much in limbo as to not know what they want.
I think that makes a massive difference, actually.
I do, too.
And I'm absolutely cast iron about what I want, so my girls will have absolutely no worries on that.
Well, I've had my funeral songs for about 30 odd years.
Oh, I'm not having a funeral. I don't want a funeral.
No, I've got two songs. Well, I don't know if I want a funeral or not, but I've got two songs that are on plane. It's a bit macabre, isn't it? It's a bit macabre. Right, we need to take our third and final advert break, and then we will be back.
Lifestyle Show.
Selina MacKenzie.
Okie dokie, we're nearly out of time for the Me Nobody Sees. We have with us Sally, Michelle and Deb. I just wanted to give mine's details out again. Somebody messaged in and said, can you give the organisations... Michelle, could you get the one that you said, Cruise?
Yes, Cruise Bereavement Counselling Services, or cruise.co. I think it's cruise.co.uk. I'll have to check the website for you, but their number is 0808 808 1677, and they are across the UK. They are a national bereavement counselling service.
Wonderful. And then the one that I gave out was mind.org.uk. That's for any mental health issues. Of course, there is a Samaritans over here in Spain if you feel like you need any help. So you can get the details of that from our website. Sally, I want to thank you so much. I know you've not been feeling well, but I want to thank you for joining us over the phone and chatting to us today.
It's been an absolute pleasure. I hope they'll come down and meet you, Michelle and Debbie.
That would be lovely.
You take care of that cold.
Yeah, take care, and I'll see you soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Take care, Sally. Bye. And Deb, just give your details out again, because I'm sure people will be wanting to chat to you.
Thank you. Yes, so my name is Deb Jones, and my website is www.theenglishtherapist.com. I don't just deal with bereavement, I deal with any other issues, specialising in addiction and sexual violence. So if there's any other issues that people want to deal with, then give me a call.
That could be another good topic for next month.
Sure.
Yeah. And Michelle, the lovely Michelle.
Thank you, as always. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you. As soon as you get your blog up and running, we'll be giving those details out too. Now, I did promise I'd just read this out because I wasn't here yesterday, so didn't get a chance. But AAA, there's going to be a mellow yellow party for AAA, all in aid of the dog sanctuary. They say eat, drink and enjoy in support of 500 animals of AAA Animal Shelter. There's a welcome carver, four-course meal, big raffle, live music with Layla. It's happening on the 16th of March, which is a Thursday, from 8 p.m. €60 per person is the cost. And to book, you need to call 622-910-214 or 630-939355. Or you can go to Restaurant Garum, which is where it's at, garummarbella.com. I will be here with more The Me Nobody Sees next month. And I will be, of course, here with your Sunday selection on Sunday from 11. Do get your request in early. I'll also be back with more lifestyles on Monday, but for today's show it is time for this.
Goodbye sweetheart, well it's time to go. We're back tomorrow with another show.
Well, unless we're fired, we'll talk to you then. Goodbye, sweetheart. Goodbye.
All that remains is for me to thank you for your company this week. I hope you have a wonderful weekend, and I look forward to being with you next week. We're going to be playing out with Darren Hayes.
Take it off me. Selina MacKenzie.
You've been listening to a TRE production. If you've enjoyed this program, there'll be another episode waiting for you next week, right here on this platform, where you can also access our extensive back catalogue of shows and interviews. For more information on our live programming, social media channels, and apps, and how to contact Talk Radio Europe, please visit tre.radio.